This episode is sponsored by Purium, the transformation company. The Mystic Manor for the first ever live taping of Optimystic. This is incredible. And wow, this is such a dream come true. Thank you guys so much for showing up. This is gonna be a one-of-a-kind journey. This is not gonna be like your typical late night style show. There's not gonna be a lot of political banter or celebrity gossip. It's late night style, consciousness elevating, consciousness expansive, talk show slash variety show slash who the hell knows what rabbit hole we're gonna dig deep down. It's unlike anything that's happened before, it really is. We're gonna shine a light on the brightest luminaries. I call them soul share interviews. We're gonna do soul share interviews with the brightest luminaries on the planet. The people, the activists, the scientists, the healers, the people that are really making a difference, that are on the cutting edge as we wake up from our slumber as a species, as we come out of adolescence and move into young adulthood and come together and realize that truly there's only one of us in the room at any given time. And it is just such an honor to be able to steward Optimystic and all that it is going to bring to the world and all the people that it's going to reach. And of course, like I said, it's not in your typical studio audience or studio setting, rather. It's in this cozy spaceship here in, you know, Venice, California. There's a live, very intimate audience, and that's just the way I like it. I want it to be intimate and real and raw and vulnerable. I mean, this is my first time up here. I'm not that slick with this stuff yet. Vulnerability is a superpower, and that is what I want to shine a light on. We're going to inject a lot of art into the show. You have, like, Vajra here, the epic artiste. She's gonna make it super pretty, make it super beautiful for all of us. We're gonna have visionary artists live painting during the opening monologue. We're going to have high vibe music, leaving us off all off on a natural high as we exit the show with like super amazing conscious artists who are really, really serious about elevating the vibration on the planet as well. So that is the focus. That is the aim of this mission. So where did it all come from? How did I get here? How did this start? Well, some of you may know I have done a podcast for 4 years, the Positive Head Podcast. It has been the most amazing labor of love I've ever experienced. It has been such a beautiful, almost 1,000 episodes at this point, 10 million plus downloads. And it has reached a lot of people in the labor of love that show has been. Getting the feedback that I've received from the people who have been touched by the show has been the most rewarding thing that I've ever done. And this, you know, if there was ever a big brother of Positive Head, it is Optimystic. This is me, you know, spreading my wings, stretching, growing to the next greatest and grandest version of myself. And it's going to be such an epic journey. I know that. It's going to focus on the same things that Positive Head focused on, which is the ultimate nature of reality. We're going to go further down the rabbit hole. My aim is to be that relatable white rabbit for people who are just waking up to the power of who and what they truly are. And the whole premise, the whole idea that is underlying what we're exploring here is that there is only one of us in the room. The consciousness that animates my form is the consciousness that animates your form. The separation between us is illusory. And when you start playing with that concept, you get shown that it is indeed what is going on. It is absolutely incredible to realize that you are one with the source that creates and animates all things. It is you. It is everything. And when you start really tapping into that, and I always say to people when I talk about this, which of course I'm very passionate about, you know, discussing this topic all day, every day. You know, when you listen to it when you explore it with an open mind, buckle up your seatbelt because you get shown. It's like, you're ready. You're ready to know. You're ready to see the truth, you know, peek behind the curtain, and it's actually you standing there. It's a higher version of yourself, some would say, right? But it's you nonetheless. And once you start tapping into that higher version of yourself, whew, it gets pretty incredible. It gets really, really incredible. And we're going to explore that in detail. We're going to talk to the people who are on the forefront of, you know, science and technology and spirituality and, you know, all the things. We're going there fully. And one of the things, well, I'd like to point out our beautiful optimistic eye emblem. Pretty epic, right? This really sums it up how I believe we ended up here in this room. Where did we come from that we're all here in these bio body suits experiencing this reality? Well, if we're one with the source consciousness that creates and animates all things, and it is boundless, it is infinite energy, infinite intelligence, it decided in eternity to create a circle, to create a boundary, sort of like dipping a glass in the ocean, right, and pulling some water out. You have a circle there. Some would say the first circle is God, the second, the goddess. This is the Vesica Pisces is what it's based off of. So when the two come together, they overlap. That's where you can actually experience reality, the contrast. That's what's going on. And the eye is us being able to see and experience and to actually have this heaven and come to earth and create heaven on earth is really what I believe we're here to do. And so this is a great symbol to sort of stand for everything that this show is going to stand for. And let's see, what else are we going to talk about? Well, it's going to get really personal. I'm going to be sharing a lot of my personal life. I'm going to be really vulnerable. Like I said, you know, vulnerability, I believe, is a superpower. So I'm going to share synchronicities, stories of magic that bubble up in my own life. We're actually including the people who tune into the show as part of the show. I'm sure some of you guys out there have been to Burning Man, and you know the beautiful thing about that that whole experience is that there isn't just some artist on stage that everyone's watching. The people are the art, and I feel like that is really important to capture with this show, to allow the listeners to come and be on stage, and that's what they're going to get to do. They're going to get to come like the very first guests that we've had here at the Mystic Manor this week are going to get to come out on stage and ask questions to the main soul share interview tonight, a question that they heard maybe based off something they heard tonight or something that's bubbling up in their own lives, maybe a challenge that they're facing. So blurring that line between the fan or the listener and the show itself is a big, big part of Optimystic. And these first three guinea pigs this week, they deserve a medal because there's been a lot of, working the kinks out, and they've been absolutely amazing. And so that's it. Basically over the course of the year, we're gonna get this first season, we're gonna do 37 episodes. We have this epic, you know, six bedroom property here in Venice where there's gonna be three of the rooms are gonna be guests, optimistic guests that are here for a full week leading up to the live taping of this show. Then they're gonna get to come out and be a part of the show, as you guys will see here tonight. So that's a super exciting and unique part of what we're doing with Optimystic. The stories of synchronicity, that's another thing that we're gonna share a lot of. One of the things, as you get in alignment with your higher self, and that's really what I think is going on, is as you become more aware, as the blinders start to expand, understanding who and what you truly are, the game becomes to sort of tap into how does my higher self view this situation, this challenge, starts looking at everything not as happening to you, but for you. Not only for you, but through you. And so now when the challenge arrives, you say, challenges are actually blessings. My challenges are blessings. My triggers are my treasures, right? This person that's showing up doing this thing to me that's so challenging that I used to shake my fist at, now I say, what is this trying to tell me about me? How can I learn? How can I grow from this? Where is the opportunity? This is where you really start to tap in, where you really start to get in alignment with your higher self and how your higher self views reality. And this is when the magic really increases in the synchronicity. As Carl Jung put it, you know, he referred to synchronicity as meaningful coincidence. And a lot of that starts to happen when you get in alignment with your higher self. You start viewing as your higher self views things. It becomes you and you become it. And this is how we all make the transition into the butterfly, the caterpillar that we now are. You know, our society has been a caterpillar, destroying everything. And that's basically, if you know the story of the caterpillar, that's what it does. It you know, once it's born, it eats everything in its path. It destroys all the leaves. It's, you know, just eating, eating, eating. Then one day, all of a sudden, a imaginelle cell, they call it, pops up. And at first, the caterpillar is like, what is this, this imaginelle cell? This is, you know, it's an invader. Kill it. Destroy it. And they do. You know, the caterpillar cells went out, and the imaginelle cell is destroyed. But then another one pops up. And then another one pops up. And then after a while, they all start working together. And then the tide really turns at that point. There becomes a point where the imaginelle cells take over. And they basically, this is the end of the caterpillar and the beginning of the butterfly. It goes into the chrysalis. And it takes all that destruction that the caterpillar created. It basically melts down into a goo that fuels the imaginelle cells. It feeds off the destruction, the pain that was caused, and turns that into the butterfly. It's born from that. And that's exactly what's happening with our society right now. We are transitioning into the butterfly that we're all meant to become, collectively and individually. Before we dive into today's SoulShare interview, which I'm really excited about, I would like to step over here and see what sort of wizardry this is that my good friend Vajra is cooking up over here.
Vajra, so, what is this about?
You've been talking a lot about synchronicity, and the thing that brought us together in the first place was you purchased a painting of mine based on Plato's myth of the demiurge.
Right.
And so you call me up and you're like, hey, I've got this amazing project going. I'm like, that sounds amazing. I have the perfect piece for it. Turns out I'm currently working on another piece based on another Platonic myth. This is based on the allegory of the cave. And so basically, long story short, it's these people live in their lives, their entire time in a cave. All they know is the shadows on the wall. And one day this person leaves the cave and they go on this little quest. They finally see the truth. They're blinded by it. They can't even process it. It blows away everything they've ever thought before. And when they go try to share that truth, the others down in the cave, everyone's like, oh, he's like, you know, a bird has feathers. It's blue. It's iridescent. And they're like, dude, it's a flat shadow. It just goes, you know, across the wall. That's it. And like, people call him crazy, but really, like, you know, they just don't understand what he does. And so I believe our purpose is to get back to the cave to share that truth. But one thing that I think is a pretty relevant theme is that Plato talks about the world of form, where everything exists as a perfect idea. So versus the physical world, that's a reflection of that world. So we've got the physical cave, but we also have this non-physical cave in the background where the pillars have kind of formed out of toruses, and there's this like little like shining little trail, the idea of a trail still existing toward truth. But that in itself is a cave. And in the end, truth is more or less just a direction to point yourself toward. Mm. And there is no actual path to get there. And so I wrote a poem that kind of summarizes my belief about this piece. And if it'd be OK with you all, I'd really like to share it.
Yes, please.
So it begins with the words of Mara to the Buddha when he had that revelation. He's like, who's going to even believe you? What's the point in sharing what you know? Nobody can understand it. And so it begins with, so what? Who will believe you? No one. Contradict the going word, they'll call you crazy and absurd. Eyes in darkness have adjusted, paradigms enthroned and trusted. Birth and death in cycles pass, while bones and fallacies amass, a seed of light you must return. And while the criticisms burn, you must continue shining bright, that the rest may take their turn and step into the light. Few will ever listen, fewer still will heed the call, that life beyond the cave is more than shadows on the wall. Remember, though, these truths we've seen, the things we know and what we've gleaned are merely rungs in a great ladder. Opinions and convictions stack, but they don't really matter. And while you've been bold and brave, the cycle catches you again, realizing in the end, it's just another cave. And so, you know, I feel like it was a perfect piece to share on this opening episode of yours, because your show is all about sharing your truth, no matter how radical or how crazy you seem, because it's what we believe makes the most difference to the people still living in the shadow.
Yes.
And so that's why I said yes, brother. I'd
love to be here. Ah, I love you. Epic, absolutely epic. The poem is just like this excellent bonus that we couldn't have. Wow, thank you so much. That was epic. And now it is time for us to bring out our soul share guest, Shaman Durek. Durek hails from a long line of spirit shamans He acts as a spiritual guide, bridging the gap between the spiritual and physical worlds by applying ancient teachings to modern problems. He's impacted thousands from all walks of life, public figures, celebrities, CEOs, little children, mental health experts. Give it up for Shaman Durek, everyone. Shaman Durek, welcome to the show, my friend.
Thank you.
So wonderful to have you here after having you on the podcast, 6 months probably ago?
Yeah.
Maybe a little more.
Yeah.
I got so much feedback. So as soon as I knew that Optimystic was going to be born into the world, you came to mind instantly. So to see you here and have you here for this is so awesome. Thank you for showing up.
It's a pleasure. Thank you for having me.
You've got a lot going on in your world, even in that last 6 to 9 months, whatever it's been. It's been quite the whirlwind for you, huh?
Yes, it has.
I know there's been a lot of press with new love in your life.
Yes.
Yeah, so a princess, huh?
Yeah.
Wow, all right. So tell me a little bit, you were telling me a little bit about that before we turned on the camera, before we sat down here, and how it's really kind of charged a lot of people and sort of stirred some things up. I'd love to, you know, hear your take on that a little bit.
Absolutely. So, you know, for me being a shaman and for her being the princess of Norway and being a part of the royal family, coming into a relationship, anyone who gets close to a royal family member on any level, be it dating or marriage, is always going to get ripped apart from the press. Yeah. But the thing for me, it's also because of the color of my skin. Yep. It's because of the fact that I'm open to, you know, I'm fluid in my sexuality. I'm, you know, I'm also a shaman. So, you can
all
imagine.
The things.
Right.
Got it. Did we miss any? No, I think we got them all.
Okay. Yeah. So, yeah, so the thing is that what happens is that everyone's issues is coming out.
Yeah.
So, you know, you're getting a lot of press worldwide, you know, paparazzi following us everywhere we go, which has been a challenge for me because I never experienced that level of people in your face every second, everywhere you go, just cameras, you know, taking pictures of
right.
you. And not only just you, but also your family members and going to your mom's house and chalking in front of her house and waiting for her to open the door. I mean,
wow.
It's been really intense. But the other thing also too, the stirring has been a lot of the racial issues
yeah.
and a lot of the sexual issues and a lot of the issues that are around women and what I'm doing in the world and being a shaman and so forth. And so, you know, you get, you're getting the racism from all over the world where people writing me saying they want to lynch me, they want to do
wow.
this to me, you know, they want to kill me. How do you bring a, you know, a person like me into the royal palace? And then, you know, I have she's amazing, strong, powerful woman. So it's not like we're, you know, I'm just, there together, we're a strong force. But she's also, you know, come from this place of being the first monarchy to come out and say, you know, of the monarchy family to come out and say, hey, I speak to spirits, I am in holism, I write books for spirituality, I opened the first spiritual center in Norway. You know, so she's you know, a powerful force in her own. And what we do for women empowerment and the way that we operate and the things that we get involved in, it stirs the pot for a lot of people.
Yeah.
And it brings up a lot of issues. And for me, in the beginning, it was really intense. I had some breakdowns, I'll be honest about it. And then I pulled it in. You know, and I called a lot of my friends who are public figures, and I was like, how do you handle this? And they're like, they don't know you. So, you know, your tribe knows you. The people who you spend time with, you give love to, they know you. So people are going to say what they're going to say. And the way I look at it and the way she looks at it is that, you know, we have lived together in other lifetimes, and we've come together again, and we've come to put the power back in people's hands. And we are also here because we love each other unconditionally. And
yeah.
If we didn't, we wouldn't be together, because we believe very strongly that if you're not amplifying love, there's no reason for you to be together. And that goes in business, that goes in love, that goes in every aspect, right? So we are showing an example to the world of what's possible. And for people who have an uncomfortableness with that, be it color, be it whatever it may be, let it get stirred. I believe in ruffling people's feathers because it really helps them to grow. And that's how I look at it.
Yeah. Yes, absolutely. Yeah. little nod to the princess, yeah. I got this. Princess Martha Louise is here. Thank you for coming and supporting. It's to me, it's sort of reminiscent. You think of the 50s when, like, you know, a black woman and a white man or whatever the combination was. It was like such a huge controversy. And now you start here in this day and age, you think that sort of thing is kind of over, but then you take that into a royal family and now you're starting to get really close to the core of, you know, this old system that's ready to be uprooted and to evolve and change. And so I applaud you for setting that up in your whole path on this planet. I would imagine you guys prearranged this whole thing
before coming
prior
to Earth.
Incarnation.
Yeah. I mean, we always make this comment. We always say that, like, whatever we do, it's not really us doing it. It's spirit guiding us, right? And we don't move unless spirit guides us. And I think also, too, which has been really interesting to me, is that the racism comes from both sides. So it's not just from the white side.
Sure.
It's coming from the black side as well. It's like, how dare you be with this woman when there's all these beautiful black women out there you could have been with.
Right.
And everything. And then there's like, well, you should be with men or you should be with women. And what about this? And it's just, to me, it's just let it come. Let it come. Because I always say comments and all these like people trolling and all that, it's really this modern day witch hunt.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah,
and but it is, the cool thing is we're not just one, we're not just two, we're many. Mm. And that's where we get to really like see the power that we've achieved from the guru consciousness that people have, is that one person who's stepping forth. It's not about that, it's about the tribe. And we're all leaders and we're all here to leave legacy.
Yes.
And so that's what I believe.
Yes. Absolutely. You know, I love these. Now, of course, we can have genetic testing done, and I think that's such a wonderful advancement because we can see, hold on, we're all mixed up. We're all, you know, I think a lot of people are probably getting quite the surprise when they find out what's in their heritage, what's in their DNA, and it's like, it's such a silly notion when you understand that, and then you think about, okay, because you're dark complected and you're light complected, you don't belong together. It's like, it's just... It's a wild thing. It's wild for me to hear that it's still going on today. And of course, you add in the gender fluidity, the spiritual aspect, you know, what the work that you do. I mean, some of the things that I saw, even the, you know, when you were on the Positive Head podcast, it was you were claiming some pretty fascinating and powerful. You're making some powerful statements and claims. And if you guys want to go hear that, that's episode 802, by the way. And you can hear some stuff that he did there. It was, I mean, I found out there was some validation later that went on that I was like, wow, like he really went for it. And he really, you know, walking the walk and walking the talk. And so, yeah, it's pretty incredible. Maybe tell us a little bit about your path. You know, you're multi-generation shaman from Africa.
Yeah, so my family comes from Ghana and Haiti. And my great-great-great-great-grandfather and then grandmother, from generations down, they were shamans in the tribe, in the Lukumi tribe and the Yoruba tribe. And then it was just passed down from one generation to the next until it got to me. And the interesting thing about it is that when people think shamanism, they always think and associate plant medicine.
Right.
They think a shaman is based in plant medicine.
Yep.
When in fact, our training is about anthropology, sociology, understanding human dynamics. Why do human beings migrate? How do they migrate? How do they associate? How do they communicate? And how do we create a sustainable a relationship with each other to be able to coexist with difference in who we are as individuals, right? And it's like every cell in the body is operating in this autonomy, but also in this collective. And yet we as human beings have not been able to figure out how do we do that? We always looking outside to find out who we are by what media shares with us or what magazines show us, billboards tell us to buy, or who our friends think we should be, and then we take on those ideas. And shamanism is about bringing everything back to the core, removing all point, all aspects. So growing up in a family that was very strong, but then also having a father who was trained in shamanism since he was a kid, he was apprenticed to my great grandmother, and my family's lineage. And then when he got older, he wanted to push it away.
Mm-hmm.
But even though my grandmother was like, you're going to have a son, and he's going to be the next in line, and you have to prepare him. So it was always this clash with my dad, which was always like, yes, we have these powers, but don't show it to the world.
Right.
But hide it behind the door. But then I won't hide it behind the door sometimes. But then I will, and then I'll get mad at you for, you know, sharing it. Okay. And so
very confusing.
And not only that, but then you grow up as a child with these abilities and your powers get stronger and stronger and stronger and stronger. And then you have all these intense things you have to go through to prove your ability and your family that you have achieved certain levels of abilities to access to be able to be of service to the world. So it's not just I'm taking a plant medicine and digesting it. It's like, no, plant medicine is like the tiny itsy bitsy aspect of shamanism that we deal with all these other levels that we have to deal with. And when we are growing up and you're dealing with that and you're dealing with it in not in Africa, but you're dealing with it in a suburban town, a little bit outside of San Francisco, and everyone's going to school and riding bikes and everything, mm-hmm. and you're watching spirits and you're looking at your teacher and going, you're being mean today because you had a fight with your husband last night. Yeah. Like you start seeing everything and then you think your friends understand you and they're looking at you like the freak because right. you're saying things that are scaring them and then they're telling their parents and then you're not getting invited to birthday parties and you're always alone. And then when people did come over to my house, it was always to see the freak, you know?
Right.
So it was really about me looking at my freedom of who I am and asking myself, am I willing to honor my freedom over someone's need over my need to get someone's love from someone? And I chose my freedom. And so that's why I can go to countries like Israel in the middle of bombs and wars and be in the coup in Turkey and stand up where ISIS is on the border of Gaziantep and where bombs and people are putting bulletproof vests on me and doing all these things. The reason why I can step into that space is because I got to a level inside of myself where I don't need your validation. And I think that's also great for my relationship as well, because when people are just constantly talking bad about me all the time, it doesn't, to me, it's like, that's your issue. I'm here for something greater, and I'm not here to be in the Maya and get caught up in it. Right. You know, that's why I don't watch like award shows and do all these kind of things. Like, I'm very focused about women empowerment, putting power back in young girls. And so for me, growing up as a kid, I did a lot of work in battered women shelters, and that's how I really started my work as a women empowerment leader. And really, you know, learning all of these facilities and these faculties of thought and education and shamanism really helped me to be able to do what I'm doing today, which is to just stay my path and put the power back in people's hands and like show people the matrix is real and really like wake them up to their own power. And so when people meet with me, you're not having a session with me, you're having a session with yourself. And I'm just kind of holding the space of unconditional love and giving you these kick-ass tools to be like, here, play and see yourself. And then I'll just hold space for you to see your power. And then you just be this illuminated being and come out and let's just walk this path together.
Wow. Yeah, I think that's a powerful, powerful statement. And it's something that I've subscribed to for some time. It's like, we can heal ourselves, right? Having someone powerful enough to hold the space to create the container is really, really important. And you know, that sounds like exactly what you're focused on, and not saying, hey, it's all me, it's, you know, I'm...
Nothing to do with me.
Yeah.
Never. And that's the thing that I find interesting when I look at the spiritual context of, like, what the narrative that I see everyone operating in, this very guru, go to the shaman, get ayahuasca, do this, do that. It's making humanity codependent, mm-hmm. and in order for us to be leaders, we have to be independent. And that's what the system wants. The system wants you to be codependent so they can build more systems upon systems to give you more things to be codependent to. And so for me, my whole thing is like, if you can't stand in front of me and access your power, but you're constantly thinking that you're gonna get it from some plant medicine, that's the only way you can access the spirit world, I'm gonna show you how to access the same exact experience that's more intense and more like in your center without you thinking everything's outside of you to go get something. Now, you can walk on tons of fires and you can go to as many workshops as you wanna go, but at the end of the day, it's your choice to either accept that you're powerful or not accept that you're powerful. And that's it.
Right.
There's no, it's not about how many books you read or how many colleges you go to. Do you accept it or do you not accept it? And that's it.
Right. And once you understand who and what you are, that's the first step, I feel like realizing like I am one with the source consciousness that creates and animates all things. I have as much right to be here and to create abundance and magic and all the good things in life as any other person that ever has been or will be, right?
Yeah, and you know, in shamanism, we have this belief that God is not Santa Claus, right? Source is not Santa Claus. It's not doling out the good,
right.
You know, to the good and punishing the bad with a lump of coal,
okay.
Right? So we believe very strongly that Source is an amplifier of code. And so you are the writer, you are the writer, that person's a writer, that person's a writer, and we're all writers of code. We are code writers, just like we write code for computers and we write code for most of the system that we have today. Everything is based in codes, frequencies, energies, codes, and symbols. It's like 1111, 12121, 333, 444, these are all codes. Symbolisms such as Reiki, this thing, Jore, all these symbolisms you see, these are all codes, but they're fragmented into what we call zip drive, right? Like a zip code, but they're into a symbol, but they're all codes. And so our body is made up of code frequency. Food is made up of code frequency. So everything is operating code frequency, and we are the writers of that code every time we open our mouths, every time we think, and every time we react. Yeah. And so whatever we do, it just gets amplified. That's all source is. It just goes, oh, you wrote that? Oh, okay, what? You think men are hard to come by? Okay, yeah. Ego, make sure there's no men for them and only the bad ones come in. Let's bring all the bad ones in.
You understand? Bring them out from behind the curtain, everyone.
Yeah.
March on out.
So it's really important that you become excellent at writing code. And the way you become excellent at writing code is that when you look at the water that's dirty, you don't go, oh, the water is dirty and the world is falling apart and no one's waking up. You know, oh, the water is healing right now. And there's all these amazing, powerful people right now who are waking up to bring understanding and collective consciousness to how we're going to be able to mitigate and eliminate all of these things that we're dealing with.
Abracadabra, I create as I speak. We are casting spells. We are spelling with every word that comes out of our mouth, every feeling, every emanation. We are the ones making it up. The stories that we tell are so important, right? And that's what I always say is like anytime something is coming across your path, especially when it's challenging, what's a story that I'm going to tell about that? We tell stories over and over that are so disempowering about what it did to us and how it took this away from us. Instead of, if you get really creative, you can say, okay, this thing happened to me and it's actually leading me to this better thing. And you just, I just make shit up.
Yeah.
And then it turns out, next thing you know, you live in the Mystic Manor and you're doing a show.
Yeah.
Like, and anyone can do it.
That's right. That's right. That's right. I think what's happened is that we, in shamanism, we have this belief, which is the base belief, which is all stories, right, are the things that are actually expanding the person. So that's why in a lot of shamanic cultures, from African culture to Mongolian culture to Peruvian culture to Native American culture to all of the different cultures in shamanism, the Sami people, you name it, and Nordic culture, storytelling is really important. And it's always the elderly women or the elderly men, mostly the elderly women, who will tell the stories. And then these stories are to adapt empowerment and wisdom and insight and understanding into those in the tribe so that they can actually grow and then tell their stories from those stories, and the stories get passed down from generation to generation to generation. But one of the biggest things that has happened in society, which is why stories are not as prevalent as they should be, is because we've been pushing the elderly out of our circle. And they are the wisdom tellers. They are the ones who bring in the wisdom of their experiences to give it to us, and then we take those stories and mold them into new stories and so forth. And that's why I'm very strong about, like, we need to really support elderly women, elderly men. We need to start bringing them back in and start having conversations with them and seeing them as the new hot and cool, right? And really start really learning from this wisdom that they have, and so that we can keep weaving this beautiful tapestry of life and not run out of string, because we started making the most important thing about, like, what's hot, what's cool, and Kim Kardashian and Paris Hilton, whoever all these people are, whatever it is, it's taking us away from the teachings of Martin Luther King and Michelangelo and JFK and Helen Keller and the people who stood for things that they felt was in opposition, and they showed that they could actually overcome through it, through the power of spirit and through the power of strength and through moving past adversity.
So you have a passion for sustainable evolution.
Yes.
Let's talk about that.
So sustainable evolution basically is that we have so much operating under the context that if we create sustainable, you know, living, our homes and our environments, our food and all of these things, that that's actually what sustains us. And yeah, those are great things. Again, it's a model for the outside. It's not the model for the inside. And so much we are operating in this field of construction and building from the outside that we create a narrative that supports those things, saying if we do this and do this and we live in a sustainable house and we have sustainable food and we do all these things, that we're actually making change on the planet. And so I've been working with a lot of scientists worldwide and really coming to an understanding of the formation of how we as individuals grow in our ability to expand beyond the consciousness of which we actually been programmed with, which is our school systems, our parentals, our guardians, and our authority figures, which is always based on the idea that something is missing and something is missing from us. And so we have this yearning. So it's easy for consumerism, it's easy for media, it's easy for anything to plug us in to something that's feeding us poison and degrading us in the need that we need something because we're not good enough, we're not love enough, we're not this enough, we're not that enough. And we start buying into that narrative and actually starts creating distortion and destruction within our own cellular process, the way we build inflammation in the body, the way it affects our cerebrum cortex, the way it affects the building of our mitochondria and really having that healthy cell growth in our body. So for me, sustainable evolution is about how do we sustain within ourselves. One of the biggest problems that, you know, and I was speaking about it in Spain recently in a lecture with a bunch of doctors, that we're dealing with a lot of depression, suicide, we're dealing with a lot of mental issues, we're dealing with a lot of issues where people are not being able to understand that they already have post-traumatic stress disorder that's already existing in their spiritual and emotional body. It just may not be physically. The movies you watch when you see something killing another person, or if you see people killing each other, people fighting in stage and punching each other in the face and doing all these things, are actually creating waves of distortion that are creating destructive codes in your being that says it's okay for this stuff to exist. And that's why war continues on our planet. And so we have to become a lot more sustainable in ourselves. And that's how do we sustain happiness, where we don't have to keep going up and down in a roller coaster of happiness. How do we sustain healthy relationships that are amplifying love out of the idea of pitting each other in this power game with of who's right, who's wrong, and you know, and I'm afraid of love and I'm not afraid of love, and all these games that people play in relationships. How do we create sustainable understanding of preservation of culture? Right, you know, anything that seems different or in foreign to anyone, we have a tendency to take this old belief system, which is if there's a tribe that's different from the one that is, you find fear, and that fear makes you want to go out and attack them and cause insult to them to protect the fear that you actually feel that you don't want to take responsibility for. And so what you have is right now, it's all these people are now looking for the monster. They're pointing the finger outward, looking for the big, bad, ugly. And then now our planet is like, the more you suffer, the more popular you become. And it's become the suffering popularity game. That's not sustainable. None of those things are sustainable. What's sustainable is when we begin to nurture our inner, so that inner is so sustainable that we can generate our own happiness, our own this, our own that. So prosperity is constantly flowing. We're always in that flow. We're not in the lack, limitation, scarcity mode. Then we're able to truly step into who we are as sustainable beings. And that's what I mean by sustainable evolution, is that we need to evolve through the sustainability of humankind. Not everyone's concerned with the Earth. Look, the Earth can freeze over and be a big ice cube in the middle of the universe. We have to thrive as a species, and the only way we're going to do so is to create sustainable evolution within ourselves.
Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. It is always about coming back to the self, right?
Yeah.
Always coming back to, you know, as within, so without. And so many people, I think, feel disempowered because they think it's so big out there, it's so massive, there's so much problem, so much disarray. And when you start taking this whole idea that you are living in your own private universe, mm-hmm. Y-O universe, and everything is a reflection of you in some way, shape, or form, and you're this multidimensional being that's, this is all sort of a light show that you're dreaming in a sense. And like now, how powerful is the story that's happening overseas or whatever's happening down the road that you feel so disempowered about? If you get into a state of, you know, I've often thought of it like, you know, there's all these different timelines where based off of where I'm at depends which one I'm going to step into.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm sure you're familiar with this whole idea. And so when you start thinking of it in those terms, it's like, what's going to happen in the future may be totally different for me than someone out there who's hearing this at this exact moment. If they all of a sudden decided, you know what, I don't believe any of this stuff, I'm going dark, and they focus on negative, 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 you know, everything, 10 years from now, they may be in some other timeline that is a more of a reflection of where they're at. And really, we're like ships passing in the night, right? I've stepped into, if I've held the vibration of something that is a timeline that is, you know, where heaven on earth is happening, we're here to heal all that. I'm telling a totally different story, as an example. And so I feel like that is a very empowering way to look at it, when you understand that it's like you're having your own private experience, and everything and everyone is a prop, in a sense, in your life.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, to add to what you were saying, you know, in shamanism, we believe in the nucleus, right? So we say all suffering comes because human beings leave themselves from the nucleus. Mm-hmm. So that means that in your nucleus, there's just you as the source. Mm-hmm. And any person that penetrates the cell or the field of your awareness, it's because you've created them to penetrate it because of what you've done inside. So when a woman comes to me and says, you know, my husband cheated on me, I go, well, you've been cheating on yourself for years. And now he's just showing up and revealing to you what that looks like, when it feels like, mm-hmm. because you haven't been listening to what you've been doing internally. When someone goes, I don't feel like no one understands me, it's because you don't understand you. When you feel like, oh, I don't feel like there's enough money, I don't feel like there's enough this for me, that's because you don't see the abundant nature of your own internal being. You don't see that you are, that, you know, everyone's obsessed with the vampires and all this kind of stuff, and I see it a lot in the media, but we are eternal beings. This is just one embodiment out of the billion embodiments we can take into other forms with other eyes and other arms and maybe no arms and maybe just squishy bodies. The thing is...
Blobs, if you will.
Yeah, as you will.
In shamanism, the way we look at this chair is that this is not just a chair. This is someone's consciousness or a group of people's consciousness. And at any given time, I could just choose to like go in and we can go into that consciousness and ride that consciousness to all the different people who created this chair. We have access to frequencies and energies that go far beyond what we actually see in our own dimension, but it's all based on your perception and it's all based on your open data, meaning your willingness to let go of your judgment, of your ideas, of what you think is possible, to the limitless expansion of everything being possible.
Yeah. Woo. Yeah, it makes me think of, I don't know if you ever heard this, supposedly when the Spanish first came to, you know, North America, at least the story that we know of course, there's been visitors and people here going back who knows how far, but when they came, you know, what, hundreds of years ago, the natives supposedly couldn't see the ships because they had never seen anything like it, so their eyes couldn't perceive something that was not, you know, part of their knowledge, part of their history. And it was actually the shamans that could first see the ships, and then over time, it's like, hold on, there's these things coming, like...
They saw the water.
Yeah.
Yeah, so they saw the ripples
in
the water.
Right, that's right.
Because in shamanism, our first part of our training is observation of movement. Mm. And so we observe like how many times you blink, how many times you breathe. We watch how many times your eyes dilate. We watch if the leaves are blowing, if the wind is blowing, if the waves are moving a certain way. And we take images of it. And if it is change in the frequency of any of those things, we read the change of that frequency. So the shamans were looking at the water.
Yeah.
They saw the change in the water. Wow. And they go, oh, what is this? This is weird. Why is it like, it wasn't like, the water doesn't move like this.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so they kept going back and staring at the water, and they started seeing, and that's when they started seeing the ships coming in. But it's a powerful thing, yeah.
Yeah, very, very powerful. Wow. So let's talk a little bit about the giant age.
Yeah.
What is the giant age?
So I talk about that in my book, actually. But the giant age, basically, to me, is that we are actually in small, tiny, little bodies. And that what we really are giants, and what we come from is this giant, you know, what you want to call the inner planes of light, is we are giants. We are like bigger than the universe, right? And we fit ourselves into these tiny little bodies. And when we're in these little bodies, we begin to believe that this is who we are, because the microisms and the bacterias and all the fungi in our body knows eventually it belongs to Earth, that it will die. But we are these eternal beings. And so we are this giant inside this body, but we've been told to play small. Mm-hmm. And so that's why people are looking for everything from like peyote to iboga to this, to combo, to capo, you know, to anything that like, to sapo, to anything that is going to take them to a place of recognizing their giantness, right? Mm-hmm. Because everyone knows they're lied to. Everyone knows they've been lied to. Since the day they arrived, they knew they were lied to. It's like, okay, come on, really? Okay, so I'm supposed to believe that I'm not loved unless this and that. Like, we know intrinsically that we are pure love, but we also accepted the lie because we wanted to believe in our families and our guardians and our, you know, parentals and authority figures and whatnot, to say, well, they should know better, they love us, so we should play their game. And then we come out of that game. And what I call the giant age is where we are right now, is that we're recognizing our giantness. And so we're not putting it with bullshit anymore. We're not in for the game anymore. We're tired of the nonsense. We want to simplify things. We know how powerful we are. And so everything that's coming against your power, you're actually rebelling against it, because the giant in you is like, I've had enough of playing small. And I've come to be a giant, and this is the giant age, and the giants will walk this earth.
And when the giants say, I'm ready to play large, you've kind of got to move aside, right? You don't really
get... I mean, that's what it is. And so, you know, I look at it as like the precursor of what's happening with this blackout, which I'm sure you'll ask about. But the thing is that it's important right now, where we are right now in our evolution, to recognize our individual source of power. Because look, it's the same thing I said, like, the system right now is built upon the understanding that you are not going to question what is happening, but you're gonna go ahead and be a bobble. I call it being a bobblehead. You're just going, yes, 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 right? And so being a giant is recognizing that there's something off in the frequency, which means that the frequency is telling you 80% of your life is spent in survival and 20% is spent in enjoying and figuring out your life, when it should be, like, all of your life should be about enjoyment and figure and having fun and being having great conversations and great dinners and making love and just enjoying the beauty and the bless and art and dancing and, you know, and just laughing and being a kid, you know. And yes. So we have to return back to that, to that nature, is to recognize that the only way we're going to be able to shift the system is that we ourselves have to shift our perception and how we see ourselves, and we're giants.
Yes. Absolutely. So I have a forthcoming book here, Spirit Hacking. So that's one of the things that you talk about in the book.
Yeah, I talk about everything from social issues, why certain leaders are showing up, as far as like why we have certain leaders showing up the way they are, to women issues, to, you know, what's happening in our drug administration culture, as far as like, you know, pharmaceutical companies, to understanding different shamanic keys that you can use in your life to access your powers in a way quicker way. Because spirit hacking to me, one of my best friends, and he wrote the foreword to it, is Dave Asprey. He started biohacking. And, you know, he said to me, Durek, you're a spirit hacker, because you've shown me how to access, like, changing the heart rate in my body. Like, I would sit with these doctors and they're like, show me how to change my heart, change my breathing, or lower my blood pressure, just with going in and using your powers in your spirit. And we have so much powers inside, and literally we're all walking Jedis, but we've been told that we don't. And we've been told it's only in movies, and we've been told it's only in these types of things. And spirit hacking is about getting back to that place. It's removing the layers. Most shamans that I work with around the world and I talk to, they're always like, oh, the people aren't ready for that. They're not ready for that. Let's just give them the medicine and see what happens. Yeah, Let's give them the medicine, see what happens. I don't believe in that. I'm a spirit shaman. So my culture comes from putting the power back in your hand. It's like, you have the ability to do all these things. You can talk to spirits. Like, I couldn't imagine anyone walking out the door and not having full access to their ancestors. And because your ancestors on the other side can open up doors for you, they can move things for you, they can make things happen for you. We talk about that in the book. We talk about so many things, and we give you like over 40 different spirit hacks that you can do to hack your life and make this, like, what you would learn in shamanism would take 20 years, you learn it in like 15 minutes. And it, people, like, It's you know, the book is, my first book that I wrote was in Turkey, and I wrote it in Turkish, so I had to go learn the language in Turkey to write first book, and it was for women empowerment. And I said, when I write my book for the world, for America, it's gonna be for the world. And now it's being published in every country around the world. So it's not just launching in the United States, it's launching in Spain, it's launching in Denmark, it's launching in England, it's launching in Africa, it's launching everywhere. And it's about really creating, you know, change in the self.
Yeah. Super exciting. Congratulations for that. I look forward to diving in fully and really learning some of these hacks. And, you know, one of the things that comes to mind, having crossed people who sort of facilitate plant medicine and hearing other people's perspective on shamanism and this idea that it's this, you know, well, you know, I think of one friend in particular who's like, look, you've got to be from a lineage to call yourself a shaman. Mm. And it's this sacred thing that, even though in his case he's been facilitating plant medicine for 25 years, you know, that's his path with it. He's like, yeah, I don't call myself a shaman, though. I'm not part of a lineage. And so what's interesting for me is, here's someone who is part of a lineage, and they're writing a book on, like, here's all the hacks. Here's how you can learn what I learned really quickly. And it's such an interesting in different sort of approach than some of the things that I've heard in the past. And so I'm curious, you know, do you expect to get, you're probably used to getting a lot of blowback from the people out there. You're being broken in right now, right? Do you think you will get any of that from current
shamans? Yeah, of course. Yeah. I mean, I'm already getting it, you know? I mean, I already have friends who are like, I can't believe you're so, like, just doing that, you know? The whole idea that you have to be born in a lineage to be a shaman is a bunch of baloney, first of all, okay? Because it's not the tribe that chooses you to be the shaman, it's the spirits. Mm-hmm. So I know children, like I have a guy, a little boy that I've been working with for since he was like 6 years old in London, and he's been training with me for about 4 years. Mm-hmm. He's very powerful now, and I'm training him to be a shaman. Mm-hmm. I have different kids that I work with around the world that I'm training to be a shaman, and all the adults as well too. It's not about being born in lineage. The lineage is understanding the teachings that have been passed down through generation. But mm-hmm. the thing is, the teachings come from the shaman, not from the tribe. Right. Do you understand? Right. So the spirits are the ones that choose the right. shaman. And the right. way they always choose a shaman is like, think of it like this. You're in a tribe, okay? Every person in that tribe does something. Either they fish, they hunt, they gather, they build, whatever it is. The person who is doing none of those things, even though they were told to do it, and is out like at night when everyone's sleeping, looking at the stars and hitting the tree with their stick and moldering them by themselves and doing whatever, and you know, whatever, that's the shaman. So, yeah, yeah. And so whenever a shaman is chosen from a tribal, like from tribal culture, that's what the shaman looks for. He doesn't look for the person who follows the rules. He looks for the person who is doing the opposite of the rules, because the shaman always has to live outside of the circle and watch and see how he could support or how she can support the evolution of the tribe, the nurturing of the tribe, the healing of the tribe, the what does the tribe need to sustain itself to be a tribe. And so the ancestors, the spirits, are the shaman's teacher. So you'll read in my book about some of my experiences. Some of my teachers weren't physical. Some of them would wake me up at night, I'd be sleeping, and they'd hit me in my sleep, and I would shake, and there would be like this man in front of me, and he's like, come, boy, take a walk with me. You know, and you just get used to it, because in some people, we'll go like, wow, that's crazy. That's why shamanism isn't for everyone, because you have to be very open to all of the different realms that exist and all the different spirits that exist in those realms, such as the one that we dealt with in the podcast that we first did, Lavanna, for instance.
Right.
Right? I've been dealing with Lavanna not just in this life, but in other lifetimes. I'm very aware of Lavanna. But in shamanism, we study, our training is about accessing all these different spiritual dimensions. We know so many different spirits. So when someone goes through, like at night when they're in bed and they're like, oh my God, my body can't move, and you know, and I can't breathe. I feel like something is holding my body down, right? And they think it's sleep paralysis. We know what the spirit is that's doing that. Mm-hmm. You know, or if someone is saying like, oh my God, I'm walking in the house and I keep hearing these negative thoughts and something is telling me to do these things, I know a spirit they're talking to, because that's how we train. So, but the thing is, you get to the point of shamanism, and what my goal is and what I believe and why some shamans disagree with me, and I don't really care what they disagree with, because right now I always tell my friends, like, it's time to step up. Stop giving them plant medicine and start teaching them real power, right? The plant medicine is like the last thing we're told to give if people can't open up that doorway, right? Which is not saying that it doesn't support. It does support a lot of amazing things.
Sure.
The thing is, what I'm seeing now in today's culture is that it's become the new trend. It's the new black. It's like, if you've done ayahuasca and you've puked and you've done all these things, you get social cred and street cred and social cachet, and everyone's like, oh my God, it's cool. Wow, you did it. Wow, da 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 da, and I'm gonna go do it again. It makes you codependent again. And that's what the system wants. The system's like, yeah, that's great. All the ones who are on top who don't want to give up their power and want to see us constantly supporting the system that they've built are like, yeah, keep doing more. Keep being more codependent. Never come into your real power.
Right.
Because the thing is that we have to recognize that, like, all of these things, like, it doesn't matter if you're a guru or a shaman or a mystic or a priest or whatever, we are all here to learn. Like, I am not perfect. I am on a planet of refinement. This is not the planet of perfection. Right. So therefore, there's times where I do things that run contrary to my best interest, and I'm learning as well in the process of enjoying it, embracing it, and loving it. So this whole kind of guru mentality, shaman, oh my God, blah, blah, blah. It's like worshiping another golden calf.
Totally.
It's like, oh, you know, and it's like, no. So my whole thing is like, I want to make everybody shamans, because then I sleep better at night, you know? Because then I know, I'd be like, call you up, I'd be like, yo, my ancestors sent something, I didn't get a clear message. Can you tell me what they said?
Okay, so.
You know what I mean? Like, you're like, Durek, you're not going to that restaurant today. Crazy stuff's happening. We're going over here. You know, everyone should have their power. We should be transparent in our power. And that is only gonna happen by returning back to our root. And that root is shamanism. It's the ability to be a child. Like, the true aspect of shamanism is being a child again.
Yes.
Playing. You ask my girlfriend, what is my favorite thing to do? Video games, play. I mean, I couldn't be with her if she didn't play with me and play half, like say, we play video games. I have action figures. I'm like a kid. You know, I'm like, we're gonna swing, we're gonna do that, we're gonna skip, we're gonna dance, we're gonna sing Disney songs together. That's we're gonna do path. All this stuff because that's the path. Because a shaman is chosen by their ability to be lighthearted about everything. I don't get mad at people when they don't grow. I'm like, oh, I made a mistake and I did this horrible thing to you. I'm like, okay, so what?
Yep.
Okay, moving on, you know?
The one Bible verse that I'm really a fan of, lest you become like a child, you can't enter the kingdom of heaven. You know, be the, I always say, my aim is to be the poster adult for childhood. And I believe that's the path. That is the path to heaven on earth. That's, you know, that's how we enter heaven, is becoming that childlike wonder in innocence and belief in magic. And it is, it's just a beautiful thing that you're doing. And I got to tell you guys, okay, so episode 802 is the first time he was on my show. And since he brought it up, so we're talking and you can see, you know, how he goes. And he start, you know, he brings up, somehow become this topic of possession comes up. And I'm like, you know, Durek, I never really subscribed so much to the idea of possession until my child's mother. I watched her kind of take a turn at one point in her journey, maybe 10 years ago, where she was, you know, a little bit crazy girl to, oh, wow, this is like kind of dark and kind of scary and sort of like yin to my yang in a sense, it felt like. I'm, you know, so like optimistic
positive.
And she was like, I am the queen of this dominion and you will all die if you do not bow to me. That kind of energy. And this is someone who tested genius on their IQ as a child, like, you know, no dummy, but all of a sudden, like, it was just dark. And he just goes into, you know, all of the stuff about, oh, it's a Lavana spirit, da-da-da-da-da, and he just, does she say this? Does she do this? Here's how you can disempower her. Here, say this. He went hard in the paint. I mean, he went for it. And I'm like, all right, well, he's definitely, you know, going for it. Maybe so. I can't say it's true or not true. I'm not having that experience of seeing it's a Lavana spirit or whatever. So then, hour or so later, I'm going to get some lunch or something with my son. And I'm like, yeah, you should listen to this podcast I just recorded with this guy, Durek. Really cool, really interesting. And he claimed your mother is like, you know, possessed by this Lavana spirit. And he looked at me and goes, Dad, that's what she named my new sister. And I'm like, okay, that's not Jennifer or Sally. And so I know you are beyond seeking credibility, but to me, that was like a, you know, I have a lot of people come on the show, say a lot of things, and I'm like, maybe so. I'm wide open, and, you know, and that was a pretty amazing moment, you know, like, so yeah. It's just, there's a lot more going on than people really realize. It's, you know, and I think we've sort of been shielded from a lot of it, the general, you know. Obviously, you've had a pretty unique path, and there's others who've had, you know, blasted open at 5 years old and seen spirits and all. But, you know, the average person, I feel like, has kind of had the blinders on. But now there's, like, you know, perfect timing for your book to come out. It's time for the world to wake up. It's time for people to claim their power and to remember, even if there is something that dark is out there, it's actually a tool, ultimately, for love. Would you agree with that?
Absolutely, and the desert is dry is Lavana's weakness.
Yes, that's what you said.
Lavana does not like that, and the night is cold. Yes, there you go.
Yes. Good. Things you could say to disempower.
There's different spirits have different weaknesses, you know, and some of them can't handle certain things, and some of them get more power from it. So, you know, when you were a kid and you were in your room, and like, everyone has the ability. Everyone in this room has gone to a point when they were a kid, there was something in the closet, something under their bed, there was something calling them behind them, something that they felt a chill go up the back of their neck. They just didn't know what it was. Yeah. And, you know, where I come in is to help, you know, to really help you understand what it is. Why are you getting that chill in the back of your neck? Why are you falling and you felt like you fell through all these buildings and your body jerks like this in bed? Why are these things happening to you? What do they mean? Why do you have certain birthmarks in certain areas of your body? What is it? What does it signify? Why do you? What is dyslexia? What is this? What is bipolar? What are these real things in shamanism versus what they are in the Western world? Very different context. Very different in its complete association. So it's about being able to really be the spiritual ambassador to showing you that you have all of these abilities and gifts inside of you, and to not make these spiritual laws that we see on the planet with these gurus and these ideas like you have to do this and this because you're not worthy to get this information. I'm like, open the books for everyone. Open the books, put everything on the table, let them take from what they need. We don't have time for these games.
Yes, I love that. This has been so epic so far, but it's time for me to call in a little backup.
Yeah.
As you guys remember, we have the three very lovely ladies, very brave guinea pigs, the first week in the Mystic Manor immersion that have been here having, you know, going through workshops, different healing modalities. Some of them have had some pretty powerful experiences of their own that they did not anticipate having. And yeah, I'd like to go ahead and bring them out at this time. Everybody, welcome. Jessica from Colorado. Brianna from Nevada. And Hillary from Colorado. The three guinea pigs, very, very brave to immerse themselves into the Mystic Manor this first week. And so, so happy to have you here. So blessed to have you be a part of this and to co-create this dream to reality with me. And I know Durek's happy to have you here as well to pick his brain about whatever, I don't know, maybe something, we'll start with you, Jessica, something that you heard during the talk that you want to ask him, or something else that's bubbling up in your life. The floor is yours.
I mean, surely I wanted to ask you like 50 different things, but as a special education teacher, as a white woman who works in urban public education, I wanted to ask you, what would you say to all the urban educators out there trying to make a difference, stuck in this like vortex of let's make everyone conform to our white ways, and it doesn't work, right? So I've practiced that, and I've been really lucky that I work in a school network that respects that, but what would you say to all the other people that don't feel that freedom to be themselves, and how would you talk to either the students or the people working with those students in the urban public schools today?
Well, what I would say as far as the urban public schools is concerned is that we have to develop emotional intelligence, right? And that's really a strong, a facilitator for kids and for growth, you know, both the education process and as well as working with anything that has to do with art, music, and anything of that nature. And I think what's happened for the kids, what I would say to the kids is for them to be able to seek that in what they're doing in their life, to be able to ask a lot of questions, to be able to come into that space where they don't feel afraid to express who they are and where they come from and what their culture is, and celebrate that and acknowledge that. And I would say to the educators to create more, more ways to understand the students that you're working with and that you're supporting by not thinking that everyone fits into a certain box, but to recognize by learning about who they are and taking a little bit of time to really figure out who is the person that you're actually sharing wisdom and knowledge with. Because as teachers, we have to recognize that teachers are the building blocks, right, to the way in which we perceive the world and the perception that we have. And I would say that if we operate from a place of being open data, which is meaning the ability to be open to all possibilities and all ideas of thought without putting any kind of reservation or hesitation or restraint on what someone may say or do, but kind of be a fluid person in the sense of you can talk to me about anything and I'm here for you, is really where growth is going to come from.
Well, thank you. Yeah.
Brianna, what is bubbling up for you over there?
Wow. Well, I have a couple of questions. I'm going to leave it at two. I would love to hear you talk about what you're speaking on a little bit of other people having different perspectives and why you won't step into that. And I'd also like to hear what you have to say about parallel lives here on this earth plane.
Okay, so let's go with the first one. Let me just get when people throw. When I get to, I gotta like, okay, let me put this one here. Okay, so let's go with the first one. Tell me the first one again, my love.
What you're talking about when you don't shift into other people's perspectives.
Okay, so the thing is that every human being on planet Earth is perceiving the world from the way they ate the food, the people they grew up with, the social situation they were a part of, their cultural background, what they believe is right for them as far as moral or not moral, is all subjective to each person, right? So if I go around wanting to conform to reacting to people because someone says something to me, I have to take into one consideration that they may be living in a different dimension than me. Right? So an example of that is I could be standing at a bus stop. Let's say I was standing at a bus stop and the guy next to me is living in a hell-like dimension. Okay? Mm-hmm. Everyone is attacking him all the time. That's how he sees his life. Everything he does goes wrong. Everything is not right. So if I say, I have this really amazing idea to create this business and whatever, what's going to come out of his mouth isn't going to be, oh, by the way, you're going to do amazing. It's going to be successful. All these people are going to be lining up. They're going to be totally involved and fully heart and soul in what you're doing. No, he's going to be like, are you sure you want to do that? Like, it's going to be everything that's going to reflect what his world is. And that's why it's important for us to understand that if we go by engaging and jumping into other people's mud, instead of standing outside and observing them from a place of unconditional love, accepting them from unconditional love, which is, I accept and I love you, and however you want to show up. If you want to show up blue today, great. And you say blue is the amazing color, and tomorrow you say, I hate blue and I love yellow. Fantastic. I've developed this mindset called enjoying the masquerade, right? And at a masquerade ball, someone may show up and say, I'm going to dress like this, and I'm going to be like this, and this is who I am, and this is what I choose to be, and blah, 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 and I'm going to love you unconditionally no matter what. Because for me to go and react to what they're saying or what they're doing and involve myself in that way is only going to set me back, because it doesn't allow me to recognize that. And the only way in which we can truly understand another person is to accept them without putting our preconceived ideas of what they should be and how they should show up and the expectations we place upon them. Mm-hmm. So that's the reason why I don't jump in. I just observe. I go, oh, okay, well, that's great, beautiful. Today you're an igloo. I love it. Tell me, where is it? What is it freezing in here? Like, what do we got to do? Because why not? I mean, why not? I mean. You know, I mean, you see it so much in kids. You see kids who'll say like, oh, you know, there's this guy. Like, I remember one time I was working with this kid in Turkey, and the kid kept saying like, yeah, there's this old woman who keeps coming in my room. And the dad and mom were like, oh God, the whole old woman thing again. And I said, you know, when I went around the room and their kid was there on the couch, and I said, you know, tell me more about this old woman. Like, what is she wearing? And like, what does she say? And he told me all these things, which helped me to be able to support him. Or I had another girl in New York who was like, Mom, I smell fire in this house. I smell something burning. Something's burning. The thing is, we have to, if we accept someone from a place of unconditional love and just accept them from where they are, right? And then it's easier for us to be able to help them and support them in any which way. But to jump in, like if someone's going through a difficult time and you go to jump in with your ideas and your views, you weren't given permission to do that. So I always say, ask permission. Would you like to hear what I have to say? Would you like to hear, so I have some wisdom to share with you. Would you be open to it? And if I'm starting a conversation, I always say, because I love you, because I know how smart you are, because I know how powerful you are, I'm gonna say this to you. But if someone says, hey, I don't need it, I don't force it. I just sit back and go, okay, they have their own intrinsic wisdom. They know what's right for them. Mm-hmm. But I'm not here to change them, rearrange them, or place any kind of idea or contract on them other than just love them unconditionally.
Okay. Mm. Woo. Thank you.
And then your second question.
The second question, something I'm very interested in is these parallel lives on this earth plane where people are in different cities living the same lives with very small differences, and what you might have to say about that.
Do you mean like people who are living in different types of countries in the world who have very small differences in that sense?
Yeah, we can say
based on a sociological level.
Well, no. More like a soul family connection.
Ah, Gotcha. Okay. Yeah. So you have, okay, I got you. I know what you're saying now. Okay. So you have what are called signature codes, okay? Everyone in this room has a signature code. Mm-hmm. I have a signature code. Everyone has a signature code. Signature code means that which is your truest authentic nature, right? Who you are at the core level. Like for me, I can't go into a room and walk around the room and say hello to every single person. It doesn't work for me. I sit in the couch. I wait for people to come. Mm-hmm. As we have signature codes, we also have signature relationships as well, too. Relationships that are bringing nothing but joy and harmony and happiness in our life, and there's really no conflict because there really doesn't need to be, because there's no need for power game. There's only need for up for lifting and shifting, right? Okay. So there are people in the world who you are part of that signature relation, but in order for you to connect with them, you have to come into your authenticity. Mm-hmm. And your authenticity is not for them, it's for you. Right? Because once you're authentic with yourself, a lot of times people say, oh, you have to be authentic, you have to be authentic. No, you have to be authentic to yourself. Mm-hmm. And through that authenticity from yourself, you're able to project a frequency that then opens up that doorway of consciousness that allows you both to connect. You're probably already connecting mm-hmm. through many different levels that are happening through your dreams and through, you know, words and visions that you're getting about each other. It's the same thing with my girlfriend. It's like I knew she was coming in my life, you know? Mm-hmm. It's just, I let it be. But I knew it was there. But I knew that in order for her to come in my life, I needed to do this here, mm-hmm. not do that there. And so these people are parallel. They're living with you. You may share similar things with them. They're part of your soul grouping, right? And there are different people who soul group in that one connection. So for instance, like Brendan, for instance, we are part of a soul group. That's why we found each other. That's why I'm here right now, mm-hmm. right? I wouldn't be here right now if I didn't feel that nature of spirit that says to me, yeah, whatever he asks of me, I'm gonna do, you know? Right. But there are people in the world who will say something to me that I won't do and I won't respond to because we're not a part of that. And it doesn't mean I don't care about them, I don't love them. I just know that my signature has to be in flow, right? Mm-hmm. And some people's signature is that they don't jump into darkness. They don't go into the mud and deal with these deep, heavy issues. Their job is just to hold unicorn starlight, fairy dust, and just dance around and smile and be like, yeah, you see what I'm holding for y'all? Right? And, yeah. And you know, and then there's some people who are like, I'm getting in there. I'm like, yeah, 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 ha, 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 life is so hot, it's so hot, you know? Yeah. And those people, you know, who are in that as well, that's what their signature is, so they can handle that, right?
Right.
So you, when you think about yourself in who you are, because I can just tell you right now, just I was reading some of your files, you have dream families that visit you in your dreams. And they've been coming to you since you were a child.
Yeah.
And they've been sending messages to you and telling you to go to different places in the world so that you can connect with them.
Right.
But there's been some resistance because of your relationship things that you've been holding on to that hasn't really allowed you to facilitate that level of freedom yet. You're almost there.
Right.
But it's a beautiful thing, you know? Yeah. So there's this amazing shift that's been taking place in you in the past 6 months where you're starting to get more and more hits about it. And you're like, okay, I need to organize my life in this way. Mm-hmm. But really the funny thing about it is like what my grandmother is saying is that it's not about organizing your life. It's about subtracting from your life, right? Because
right.
you have been built with this pattern because of your mom, of this whole idea is that I have to have structure. I have to have balance. I have to have structure. I have to have balance. Mm-hmm. Because for you, having that level of structure and balance makes you feel safe. Right. But in order for you to connect with your true family, you're going to have to get a little wild.
Yeah. You know?
The wildling is on the wildling. Sorry, like Game of Thrones thing. Yeah. The wildling is on the move.
Okay.
I'm pretty sure I saw a twerking video you posted once.
Oh no.
Brandon.
So maybe the wildling's already on the move.
Well, it's both. It's the part of not losing control, and it's a part of being able to be safe. But
right.
what you're learning in the past 2 years, which has been really amazing, by the way, and your guides and my ancestors, everyone's having this great celebration for you, is that you've come into this place where you've really been able to see things objectively, and instead of getting so upset about it and so like internal about it,
right.
you've been more like, you know, do I really need to be upset about that?
Right.
That is huge for you.
Yeah.
That's huge for you.
He was talking about that, you know, earlier with the first question, and what comes up for me is, it's all data. If you start looking at it, this is just feedback. You know, Don Miguel Ruiz said, nothing is personal, right?
Right.
One of the four agreements. And it's just a feedback. And when you start living your life from that perspective, as someone as fiery as I can be, it's been quite the you know, the journey for me to get to the point. And you have your moments where you fall off the wagon and you're reactive and shaking your fist like they did me wrong or whatever the story may be. But when you start making that transition to understanding, it's just all feedback. It's telling you what you need to know to do whatever you want to do next. So especially in like a relationship dynamic, that sort of thing, right? It's like, oh, okay, I'm exploring this potential relationship. Oh, here's feedback. This is showing me whether or not, as he was talking about it, being a fit. Like, is it a fit for my signature? It's not right or wrong. It's just, it's you know, why am I going to get mad at the dog for barking in the middle of the show or peeing on the carpet or whatever it does? It's doing whatever it does. It's feedback.
Right.
And as you start to sort of make that transition, we save so much energy that we give, you know, reacting to these things that are just natural for the people. Everyone's acting rational based off their view of the world, right?
Right.
And just to add to that too, you're also a telepathic empath. Mm. So let me explain to you what that means. So different types of empaths, right? There's dysfunctional and functional empaths, and then there's empaths that are visionaries, but you're a telepathic empath. That means that you pick up on frequencies from other people's thoughts, and then you start vicariously living through those thoughts through their life, and you think it's you're wondering, like, what is this thing? Is this something I should be worried about? What is this? And so that gives you the ability, one, to see when people can die, as one, which has also been one of your fears, the ability to be able to see spirits when they cross over, and the ability to have beings enter your dream plane and connect with you while they're simultaneously thinking about you or will think about you by the time they go to bed.
Right.
So what's been happening and what's going to be interesting is, one, how you deal with, when you're a telepathic empath, you have to be careful with your stomach.
Yeah.
Okay? Because your stomach's going to always be the thing that has the problem when you're not flowing in energy. And I'm going to explain to you what that means shamanically. Mm-hmm. That means that for a telepathic empath, you need to be around fire. Hmm. Okay? Because in African shamanism, we say the fire can see in all directions. It moves in all directions, right?
Okay.
And so when you are in that space, you need warmth. You need fire. You need everything warm. If things are cold around you, it's going to mess up your sensory. Mm-hmm. So you'll find yourself getting cold. You'll be like, why am I cold? What is this feeling? But your stomach is going to be the thing you have to pay attention to the most, from digestion to inflammation to any of these things, because that means that you're taking on too much input information and you're not cleansing it to the fire.
So what
would be really good for you is just some, once in a while, have a thing of fire, like throw something down, light it up, and just take the fire, move the energy around you, wash yourself with the fire, and all that stomach stuff, everything is just gonna like just smooth right out.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Would a telepathic empath experience, because her and I, you mentioned empathy, you know, connecting with others, and in the dream state, her and I had an experience yesterday, where it was my brother's birthday, and who's here, and I haven't even told him the story yet, but he had a and he had a partner that passed under tragic circumstances years ago, and I had a vivid dream about her on his birthday, the night of his birthday, and I woke up and I'm like, wow, I had a really vivid dream about, and her name was Krista. And she was like, oh my gosh, I dreamed about a Krista last night and how I need to help this Krista. And like, so we both had this dream. And then of course it was on his birthday. So I'm like, okay, what exactly is the interpretation of that? So as you're talking about, you know, we obviously linked up in some way in the dream state. I don't know what your take on that.
So, okay, well, I'll give you my take. So basically...
I hijacked that question. You're next.
Okay, so for one, birthdays in shamanism means anniversaries to self. I don't celebrate my birthday because I'm not into the matrix system that the matrix has created to make sure that I age and my cells age and everything. I'm not into it.
You're really 123, right? Tell the people.
You'd be surprised. So let's just say, for the sake of me being 2 years old, no, or five, but anyway, no, seriously. So the thing is that when you're having a birthday, it's really your anniversary to self. And what the anniversary to self is about clearing old energies, changing patterns. You've gone around the sun, so you've taken in all the planetary energies into your being, and it's about you resurfacing to yourself. Because remember, and this is something that I really say a lot, and it's really important that everyone gets this, we are not meant to fit into a structure. We are beings that are mutable and changeable, and we can change ourselves like that. I could be here second right now talking to you, and tomorrow I can wake up and be a total different person. That's the great thing about being a multidimensional being. And so when you're, what we've been taught to do is fit ourselves in labels and boxes and descriptions and paragraphs, and you know, you got it. Mm-hmm. And the point is that birthdays are about recognizing that, you know, you're being reborn into yourself again. And so when you're having that dream and you're experiencing that, what it basically means, and just so you understand, it means that there is a part of you inside that feels that there's still a helplessness that you're holding on to. The helplessness of, I didn't do enough, or I couldn't have done enough. And that frequency is creating that connection to that person on the other side, which means that there's unfinished, as we say in shamanism, unfinished energy, right, within you and the other person, because everyone who goes to the other side knows they're eternal beings. But when you're in the physical, because you share this body with all these different organisms and so forth, you get really attached to this physical, and your ego's there to also keep you attached, so you stay in this body and carry out what you've come here to do. But so the relationship of that experience for you is just as real as it was yesterday. But the person who's moved on wants you to be able to find peace and joy and happiness and move on. But because you're picking this signal up together, it's an energy of you coming into a space of recognizing that you have done everything that you were supposed to do, and any part of you that's beating up on yourself or cycling back into that energy is asking for a completion in it, a ceremony of some sort if you choose, or anything that will actually say, like, I bless you on your journey completely, and we shared this beautiful experience together, and we will continue to, but you're an eternal being, so remember, life is like a blink of an eye. Right? And so letting go of that completely. And so the idea of, I haven't done enough, the helplessness of it all, right, is about letting that go on this journey around the sun.
And that's definitely the case. You knowing, never even having met him, I don't think, that's exactly part of his experience, is holding on to all, everything.
Yeah. No, yeah.
It's true.
Wow. Crystal watch.
Yeah. Fancy. He's fancy. All right. Hillary, welcome. You're up.
Thank you. Hard to follow that. You know, I had a pretty next level experience the other night with a past life regression, which was super surprising because I didn't actually believe in past life regressions until I had that experience. And then in retrospect, I have had moments in my life of pretty profound clarity, but it's like, you know, once a decade, which I think makes me probably the least reliable psychic on the planet. You know? Every 10 years, I have a really great vision. Yeah, so I was just wondering what could I do to kind of nurture that a little bit more, to have a little bit more moments in my life where I'm feeling that clarity.
Okay, so let's change your wordage for first, okay? So words are so important because word is like literally your writing code. So instead of saying, what do I do to nurture that, to have more clarity, right? So you're saying, so I love that I'm nurturing that. So you're claiming it. So go ahead, let's change your wordage first.
I love that I'm nurturing that.
Right, and I feel so excited how I'm expanding into stronger and deeper and more defined levels of that power.
Okay.
Right? Because the thing is that as human beings keep pushing everything outside of themselves as if it's this thing that's outside of them, right? So actually, let me just ask your team what exactly it is that needs to be nurtured. Okay. Go ahead. I see. And so you're saying as far as art is concerned, right? And you're saying in order for her to be in that flow, she needs to maintain in that art space. Uh-huh. So what is that, what else is missing that you feel that she could bring in? Does any of you want to chime in? Okay, so you're saying her father. Okay, and you're saying, so letting go of that, of what exactly does that mean? Like the accolades or the acknowledgement of within herself, right? Looking for the validation. I get it. I see. So you're saying if she's looking for the validation, then it's limiting her, because in that moment she's looking, she's actually depleting herself from seeing it within herself. Got it. And then you're saying for her to be in art, which is keeping the flow of energy moving through her, allows her to be able to be an open channel. So what exactly, what powers does she have? Okay, so you have the ability of insight. You can see when something's out of balance. Okay, what else does she have? Okay, so you're saying she has the ability from another lifetime, like you're talking like nunnery? Are you talking nunnery from another lifetime? I see. And so you're saying the healing ability to tend, to take care of, to nurse back into health, to bring back into rejuvenation, and all these things like that. Okay, got it. What else? She's psychic, okay. And tell me more about her psychic ability. What type of psychic is she? She can sense other people's pain, and she can also sense what's missing, and she can put the pieces together of the different things that they need to do in order to make changes in their life. So you're saying that she has ability to see hidden keys. Okay, got it. And where is she storing this in her body? Upper shoulder, okay, what side? Left side. And where else is it? Middle of her back, lower hip, which has been causing a problem for her, needing to fix that transition. What's the transition exactly? Loss. Interesting. So you're saying loss is the transition. So the idea of losing that which she loves so much. I see. And what is the correction? Be in nature. What aspect of nature does she require? The ocean, the water. I see. And if she's not in that natural environment, what happens to her emotionally? She goes into melancholy, certain places where she gets stuck, starts following routines, and doesn't get into that deeper space within herself. Important for her to be by the water, important for her to do art, important for her to recognize, to let go of the idea of loss and know that there is a passage for everyone and everyone has their journey and not all people need to stay on earth and they're okay to leave when they want to and we shouldn't be upset at them for choosing to leave. Okay, got it. And you said holding the frequency in her body. Why is she holding it? Can you show it to me? I see. So we're talking lower lumbar, upper, upside to the hip or the iliac crest, lower upside performance area. Okay, so sciatica area in her back. Got it. Open energy gates, 14 and 25, so I can see deeper into her. Got it. Okay, so you have two parasites that have been affecting you, which affects your sleeping, which actually causes an imbalance in the way, because what it does is it actually agitates your nervous system. Where are these parasites from? They said you listen to people's problems way too much.
That's entirely possible.
Because when you're taking in people's problems, your team says is that you're taking their problems in and you're generating their energy into your body. And so it's causing your body to feel like it's being attacked instead of it's being nurtured. So when it feels attacked, you'll gain weight, your lower hip will have problems, you'll start developing types of nervous inflammations in your lower back and upper spinal, middle spinal area, medial spine towards your lower lumbar area. And also letting go of realizing everyone has their journey, right? Okay. And being okay with that and not getting to the point of why do the people have to leave? Why is there loss? Why do we have to, like clearing that out of you emotionally. Getting into art, really important, the spirit says, because art helps you flow. It helps move you, and you need to be by water. You need to be by water because the movement of water, the sound of water, allows the little girl to come out, and the little girl feels excited, and that's when your goddess energy comes out, and that's when you start feeling, oh, I want to nurture myself more. I want to do this, and you stop taking other people's stuff in. Let me just talk to the fairy realm for a second. Fairies of the fairy realm, Lady Polyphelina, head council of the fairies. What stone do you recommend for her in her highest order? Labradorite stone is going to be good for you. Go ahead. Moonstone is going to be good for you. Peridite is going to be good for you. And any stone that has a magnetic frequency, such as malachite or lodestone, will be good for you to balance out you taking those empathic energy frequencies that are causing the imbalance in the way that your hormonal system has been acting up.
All right, thank you.
Yeah.
Durek, this has been absolutely amazing. Everything I'd hoped it could be. You are such a gift, my friend. Ladies, thank you so much for showing up, being brave enough to be the guinea pigs, the first to immerse themselves in the Mystic Manor magic. It has been so incredible. Now I have one last gift to leave you all with, the gift of music. And and before we go, if you'd care to check out Vajra's art, who you saw live painting earlier, go check out alteroftheheart.com. And you can also check out his stories. His poetry was pretty epic as well, right? With that being said, let's give it up for Imagika Om. Dreams are real.
Yeah.
Before we share the musical performance, I'd like to take a moment to tell you a bit about our sponsor, Purium. As we all know, a healthy mind, body, and spirit are all three essential if we want to live our best life. So if you're looking for a great solution to optimize your physical health, definitely check out Purium. I personally drink Purium shakes and juices pretty much daily because Purium has created a proprietary low heat dehydration process that delivers fresh grass, vegetable juices, and spirulina to you in powder form that is actually still living and raw. You see, all other powders you get from the store are typically dehydrated between 180 and 220 degrees Fahrenheit, basically baking them to evaporate the water. Purium is the only company in the world dehydrating at 60 to 80 degrees, which functionally preserves over 95% of the living compounds. It's like drinking fresh organic grass and vegetable juices and spirulina without having to clean a juicer every day, and they honestly taste super amazing. They have many incredible products at ishoppurium.com. I personally recommend starting with the Ultimate Lifestyle Transformation Pack, which has most of my favorite products. And if you use the promo code MYSTIC, you'll get either $50 off or 25% off an order of $75 or more at checkout. Also, if you were inspired or touched by the retreat guest shares in this episode, you also have the opportunity to come and experience a transformational week-long retreat immersion here at the Mystic Manor in Venice, California with myself and the rest of the Optimystic family. However, as you can imagine, spots are limited. So if you feel called to spend a week co-creating magic together, as well as to join me here on the Optimystic stage, check out optimystic.tv to explore the possibilities further, and be sure to schedule a call with one of our Optimystic booking elves to seize this unique opportunity while spots are still available, and you can do that at calendly.com/mystic deal. Hope to see you here at the Mystic Manor.